Man, what a view. This is beautiful.
With the popularization of the tiny house and of the hashtag van life,
we've been romanticizing this idea. Oh yeah, just like live free, live simply. What you doing, love?
Making pancakes.
Pancakes?
Pancakes. Chocolate chip pancakes.
I think maybe like I had this idea long before I ever knew about van life. I had this idea that I would be nomadic. Our first stop this morning is Sand River. I had this idea that I would travel to a place and I would live there for 6 months and get to know the area and then travel to another and so on and so on. But then when we found the van life, when we started getting hooked on it, all those Instagram pictures that we saw of people parked in state national parks and everything looks amazing.
Welcome to Fiesta Park.
Oh, check out this parking spot. It's on the edge of a cliff and I've got this campfire and we're all singing, got guitars and it's just lovely. Like, that was a huge sales pitch, right? And we didn't know. We were just like, oh, that's what it's gonna be all about. Wicked. Cool, yeah. Let's do that. And then got into maybe like the first week of it and we're like parked in the Walmart for the third time that week. We're like, I think it's not quite like that.
Okay, we're parked up behind a shopping mall again. This time I took a look around, didn't see any shopping mall security officers. And we spent the last 4 hours at a coffee shop. We have our Wi-Fi antenna. I'd like to use it normally, but like, it's just a lot more convenient to go into the coffee shop. But then I buy one coffee, but then I'm there for like 3 hours. I feel bad, like I'm a total freeloader. Like, I'll be a freeloader anyway. I just don't want people judging me for being a freeloader, that's all. Still there. Oh boy, I've been nervous. Oh my god, our bikes are still here. Wicked. Awesome. It's a good day, Shelby, it's a good day. It's a good day. Welcome to Chef Ramsey's kitchen. We're learning lots about cooking today. Gonna do some cooking stuff.
We had the expectation that this trip would make us better people, but we didn't quite understand what that meant and how we were going to become better people. I think that somewhere in our minds we pictured this trip would just make us better people by us admiring the beauty of Earth and seeing like how awesome everything is, and it's not like that at all, actually.
It's more like this trip is going to make us better people because it's going to make us very patient by making us go through some pretty hard stuff.
Oh, can't sleep because there's an absolute monstrous storm right now. And it's shaking the whole van. It's 3:30 in the morning.
4 a.m.
4 a.m. in the morning. The storm is so bad that neither of us can sleep.
It actually feels less windy down here than it does in the bed.
This trip is giving up like a warm bed and a dry bed.
Are you comfy, Simon?
Giving up a lot of space to just think.
Screw you, you average shaped human being. I'm 6'6", okay? I find comfort where I find comfort. And I will not be subject to your judgments.
Now, that's all part of the deal that you get in order just to become a person who's more capable of keeping themselves happy within themselves.
Stupid house is on a tilt!
That, I think, has been the biggest lesson for us, is realizing that this trip isn't going to make us better people by it being an awesome trip. This trip is going to make us be better people by it being very hard and by testing our boundaries and by pushing us to the limit of what we're willing to take so that we can look back on that and know exactly where our limits are and know that we can create that happiness for ourselves. That, I think, is the greatest goal of this whole trip for us.
What?
5:57 in the morning. Shelby, wake up. We got a garage sale to run.
Shelby.
My alarm goes off in 3 minutes. can't just let me sleep 3 more minutes.
Okay, when we were living in Ottawa, we decided that I was going to move in with Simon because, honestly, we were together all the time and I wasn't using my apartment for anything more than a closet.
Day 3 of the big purge. Shelby, how's it going?
Someone's coming to pick up my dresser in like a half an hour, so I just emptied the whole thing.
Now I look back on that, you had a lot of stuff. You had a lot of stuff.
Day 4 of the stuff apocalypse. Stuff-opalypse. Kips.
Stuff-apocalypse. Under the
cops. Right? Day 476.
We have gotten rid of almost everything.
We looked at all these apartments, and then we ended up just moving into his bachelor. So when we were in our little apartment, we were running our business together still at that time, and so we had to learn how to work together literally all the time, because when we were at work, we were working together. When we were at home, we were working together. We were just, we had a long desk and we each sat at one end. We were always together.
And then from there, we just got kind of into the idea of like, well, if we can go to this mall, how small can we go?
Shelby and I just bought ourselves a 1972 Dodge Fargo Sportsman Royale van. Extended van. So we think it's pretty much the best vehicle we could have got, especially at the price. Today we're here with the whole gang. We're gonna gut the van, take out all the panels, and clean that stuff up and see what we got to work with.
So we ended up finding some sound deadener. We would plaster that on all the walls, and then we put on spray adhesive and lay down the Reflectix double bubble insulation stuff. We have to lay DC current all the way to the back and to the front on both sides. Shelby has some ideas on how she wants to paint, and it should look really nice when it's all done.
So as many of you probably already know, we lost the van a couple weeks ago. It just caught on fire all of a sudden. We think that potentially it was a cracked fuel line that was leaking, and then when we bumped into the driveway, it all exploded into flames. We had the whole film crew with us in the van. They fought valiantly to try to save the van, with me jumping through fire and smoke to save all of our gear from inside of it, but within a few minutes, the whole thing was on fire. The van is completely destroyed. There's no salvaging it. We estimate there's about $5,000 worth of damage done. It's something we can recover from. I mean, considering a van burned to the ground, we could have had it gone a lot worse. Somebody could have got hurt. So we're very grateful, but it does set us back on our plans a little bit.
Our camper van, when it burned down 6 months into our project and we lost all of that, we were a little fed up, and we knew how much work it was, right, to build your own van into like a such a small space. So we decided we'd get something that was ready-made and then just customize it, and that's what we did.
And definitely the coolest and first mod I've done is right over here. There's a Wi-Fi antenna up there, and what that allows us to do is pick up open Wi-Fi signals from McDonald's, Tim Hortons, stuff like that, from a further distance away, so we can work inside of our van instead of sitting inside the McDonald's. The Wi-Fi antenna on the top is a Yagi antenna attached to a USB Wi-Fi card, and we wire that down into the van.
So basically from in here we can rotate it and try to get more Wi-Fi signals depending on which way we rotate it.
The second exterior mod is we move the poop chute from our shower, which was sitting there, just the tube for it before, and we made a PVC pipe and mounted it underneath the side doors. This allows us to keep the tube from sticking up the inside of our van. Next, I started putting in a bunch of 3-amp, 5-volt USB outlets all throughout the van to allow us to charge our devices from battery bank without having to convert it to AC and then back down to 5-volt DC.
We put solar panels on the roof. We put an upgraded battery bank in there with a lot more batteries. We also installed a generator.
Now, lastly and most importantly, Shelby's dad built us a new table. The table is a butcher block style table, although in typical Bob fashion, he's done it to perfection. The thing is absolutely gorgeous, and the wood all comes from Shelby's grandfather's old wood workshop. A lot of the wood was harvested long before she or I were even born. So it has a lot of sentimental value. This is definitely the coolest mod we've done so far. You think so? I think it's the coolest mod. So it's one of Shelby's projects. She had this idea that a whole ceiling is just white and ugly. So we should put something on it. And what better than a bunch of maps? And Shelby is putting wallpaper glue?
Universal border adhesive.
Yeah, okay, so wallpaper glue on the maps. We're cutting them off into little sections, little squares, and then we're pasting them to the roof.
It's very fragile because it's paper, it's not wallpaper.
Yeah.
So if it gets too wet, or if I put too much glue on it, or if I touch it too much, which I tend to do, it rips. So. We're done!
First thing I did was mount these cool little clasps right here. And they clip on and off with nice quality leather. And it holds up our teapot and most popular frying pan, which clears up a lot of space in our shelves. There's a lot of it that over the last few weeks have really taught us that we just don't need. So we're digging through it, finding the stuff we don't need, and getting rid of it piece by piece. But it's an arduous process. As you can see, it's just an absolute disaster in here. There's so much stuff. And then you gotta organize it back in such a way that you can access the things you need more faster than the stuff you don't. So.
I'm gonna
whip some
bags. I like it a lot more now that it has books in it. But yeah, it might. Things might go. Shuffle forward a bit.
Well, let's take it for a test drive. Let's hit the road. So for us, van dwelling and van travel was a really economical way for us to spend 6 months on the road at a time. So we made it to Algonquin Park last night. What a ride. It started snowing. First day of my trip, it started snowing. Ugh, it's cold. But the furnace is on, nice and warm. Although we are gonna run out of propane probably tomorrow. Once she gets up, we can fold this bed away and we can get to making breakfast.
Living in a van and traveling is the cheapest, but also the most comfortable cheap way to travel. So we could have driven and like stayed in, you know, different places along the way or whatever, but having our home with us, I think was a way for us to always have some kind of comfort while we're in places that we don't know, and being able to bring like some of our comfort things with us. This is one of the awesome modifications that Simon did on the inside of the van. He got this cutting board from IKEA and he just installed it with these hinges he got from the hardware store. So we can put this up for extra counter space. What are you doing, Simon?
Cooking in the van for the first time. It's really cool, but check out this cutting board. Isn't that dope? Works so well. I mean, you can't put like a lot of weight on it, but it's nice. And this is like the area where I can stand up totally straight. This is like way more comfortable to use in here.
We kind of have kitchen stuff spread out a little bit. So we have kitchen stuff in the door here and in this door here.
Ooh, smells like garlic.
We also have kitchen stuff in this thing hanging here. And then we have some in the cupboards down below.
Our van is 21 feet long. It's about 9 feet tall. Right, look how much headroom you have. She can stand up everywhere in this van.
Yeah, I can stand up and walk back and forth, which is nice. But
it's perfect size for her.
But I still hit my head like 20 times a day.
This right here, it's a bit of an issue. I'm not gonna lie to you. I mean, like, everything so far has been extremely comfortable, but I think I need to like get a chair or something.
So it doesn't matter if you can stand up, you still hit your head.
If you've got a thick skull, the van life is for you.
Yeah.
And it's a pretty big van. It's about as big as vans get. And
It is, I would say, just barely enough space for two of us and our dog. Any smaller, I don't think I could do it. Any bigger, and you can't fit it in a parking spot. So it's a nice, sweet spot for us.
If you could see where we're at right now, that's pretty metropolis, man. So we're gonna do some downtown urban camping in Saskatoon tonight, I think.
I'm scared.
Life's an adventure, Shelby. And then you sleep on the streets. I'd like to state that our camping spot tonight is not stealth. I have the lights on right now. The windows open up all up the front here. Shelby's got her phone. The furnace is going, and I guarantee that we will not get disrupted tonight. So inside, this is the way we set it up. We don't cover the front windows, but we try to park them in such a way that they're not facing anywhere where anyone can really look in the front or is passing glance in the front. And even if they do, this cushion right here is from when the table is a couch, and that builds a little fort for Champ to hide underneath. From that spot right there, no one can see our little Champy Poo. And then to add to that, we're actually up here in our bed. And so because we're up top, if anyone looks in down here, they just see the dinette and they think, probably nobody in here. But we're actually up top. And we've got tinted windows and blinds pulled over, so we can actually have the lights on. And because it's a parking lot and there's lights on outside, you can't actually see any of the lights on inside the vehicle. Now, the story we're looking to build with where we park our van is that we're an old couple, we're quite obviously staying with some friends, or we live nearby, and this is just our camper van we've just parked here because there's no space for street parking or whatever, like something like that. The big thing though is, like, all of this stuff is cool and everything, but the big thing is you just gotta switch your spots all the time. As long as you keep moving, people might know you're camping in your van, but they don't really care. They only care once you're there for more than one night, maybe more than a week even. Most people's tolerance is pretty high. We spent the night here by a park. Almost one of the first parks we've ever seen that doesn't have the sign, no overnight parking. So that's kind of nice. And the cool thing is we actually have a bathroom right behind us and a water fountain. So we've been able to fill up some of our water bottles and use the bathroom and everything.
So up here we have our bed, and it folds away when we're working during the day, and then at night we can pull it out and it becomes a full queen size bed. There's not a lot of space, as you can see, between where you're sleeping and the ceiling, which was really hard for me at first. I felt really claustrophobic, but eventually you kind of get used to it and it's pretty cozy. So in here we have our double sink, which is nice, so we can wash the dishes in this side, and then we have a drying rack here. It's just a drying rack from IKEA that we cut down to fit RV size. The things that the van came with that we didn't have to modify was this stove, which is run off of propane, and then we have our fridge, which is also run off of propane, and it has a little freezer inside of it as well that we don't use too much, but it's there if we need it. And then here's my closet. I still have quite a lot of clothing for someone living in a camper van, but I downsized a lot. So back here we have our bathroom. It's not very big. We did have a shower here, but we found we weren't using it that much. We would just go to the YMCA, to the gym, and use the shower there. And then our toilet, we try not to use it that much, but we do use it.
Made an IKEA trip. It's the last time we're gonna be in a really major city. Got this basket with a bunch of little sliding baskets. We're gonna mount it. Comes it up.
It's a little too big, but it's okay.
A lot of the modifications, we didn't really think of them until we were living in the van full time.
And again, we have the leather strap to hold the baskets in.
We got a proper little garbage can. It's gonna sit right there at the front.
And then I also learned that it never ends.
Because we've decided not to use our shower, we've freed up a little bit more space. So I've got a little project going on in the back to take care of all of this extra stuff.
All right, so we've got ukulele, skateboard, tripod, light stand, violin, other tripod thing, umbrellas, yoga mat. All of this will fit on top of our Pelican case in our shower. And then I'm holding it all in
with two of these cheap Chinese seat belts they had originally bought for the old van and never got rid of, because, I mean, like, they're seat belts, right? You're gonna get, always find a use for seat belts.
So, this is the bathroom. Oh,
yeah, so here I am seated. I mean, it was never a roomy place to begin with, but that solves a lot of our space issues for sure. And I probably shouldn't be leaning this hard on my toilet. In typical RV fashion, nothing in this RV is really built to last, and it's already 23 years old. So I really have no problems like drilling holes and stuff at this point. I just gotta make it work, you know? For some reason, this stretch of highway, they really don't advertise the gas stations really well. I've never had the gas tank as empty as it is right now. Oh! Oh my god, that's expensive.
Oh my god!
Look at that tank though. Dry as a fart.
We spend the bulk amount of our money on gas. I will say that for us, as a lifestyle, this isn't so much cost effective, because we're basically paying pretty much the exact same as we were living in a small apartment. I will say that as for travel, very cost effective. We haven't seen a lot of North America, so the camper van seemed like a good way to see a lot of the stuff we haven't even seen yet.
Terry the Fox! I believe in you! We named him Terry Fox.
So for us, van dwelling and van travel, it was a good chance for us to get out, go see as many things as we can on the smallest budget.
We just did some street camping in Banff. That is one thing I definitely did not think we would get away with. Right there on the street, just hanging out. Shelby, how was your sleep?
Good.
What we've noticed about Banff so far is everyone's from somewhere else working here seasonally. There's tons of cool vans, and you can see the mountains all the time. It's like a utopia. That was a hot spring. Shelby finally got her hot spring experience.
I didn't think that they have like showers and stuff. I didn't think they'd have that.
Yeah, showers, changing rooms, works. So we actually even got a shower today, which, van life, that's a bonus. So the last, I want to say, 150 kilometers were terrifying, and I don't think I ever went over 60 kilometers an hour. And the speed limit is 100, and the trucks are trying to do 100, which is suicide because we've seen like three of them in the ditch.
So this whole highway is covered in signs that say, no stopping, avalanche.
Shelby's not even worried.
A little worried.
Canadian winters are brutal. If I was gonna do this whole trip again, we would totally have gone straight south, right for the desert, avoid the rain, avoid the cold.
So we're in the pass. It's like 140 kilometers and there's no towns, no cell service, no gas, no nothing. And the driving last night just got a little hairy, so we pulled over and stopped for the night. But it's cold. So cold that our pipes are frozen and our water doesn't work. So we've got two water bottles left. So I'm making coffee with a water bottle.
The van itself, it's camper, so it's got insulation, but the insulation's 23 years old. It's not the best in the world. Yeah, we've got a furnace though. That's the big thing. The furnace keeps us warm enough, but then you got condensation.
Mm-hmm.
So we got mold on pillows, we got leaks, we got all kinds of stuff.
We found, of course, all new leaks. It's just soaking wet in here. I'm so sick of being wet all the time. Cushion, ceiling, just, it's all soaked. Again.
So this is what we've learned. This is what we've learned, okay? if it comes down to you having to camp through some cold spots, you got to think of it this way. Keep the heat off, keep it as low as you are comfortable with. This will save you energy and it'll also save on condensation. And then what you have to do is, if you can, if it's just at zero and you can, keep one of the vents open on the roof. Like, trust me, the discomfort of being cold way outweighs the discomfort of being dead from mold.
Or wet and
or
cold.
Or soaking wet. Yeah, soaking wet just sucks.
The condensation this morning, it was especially bad, so I'm running the car just to heat up everything, get it in the air again, and then running the ceiling vent just to suck all the stuff out. I think Shelby got cold in the middle of the night and closed the ceiling vent. Now it's just a water world up there.
And then the other thing we do is we go to bed fully all clothed up. We wear slippers, multiple layers on our blankets, and we're always wearing toques to go to sleep. As soon as we learned to do that, every night was comfortable.
Morning.
That's the chemical dehumidifier stuff. Doesn't work all that well.
And then, like, if I ever figure out how to fully rid myself of condensation, I'll let you know.
Took it all out, and I'm at a Starbucks today. Closed for Christmas. Here's Champ, watching over the mattress as it dries out. There's his old bed, and his new bed over there. Some of the liners for our mattress, they're drying out. All of it's just a little damp, but especially here on the edges, it's quite damp, because that's right in the bulbous part of the front of the van, and that's where most of the condensation happens, which is where our heads are. So that will go down, and if we don't dry it out, then we'll get mold, and the mold right next to our head is not a good place for it. So drying it out today, and then hopefully we don't get much more condensation. I've been sleeping with the vents open and it's kept everything dry, but that moisture just wouldn't go away. So today we're drying it out.
The wind and the rain has been really, really bad. And the water outside, right along the river here, is just boiling. So we're gonna have some breakfast. We're gonna sit around, maybe wait for the weather to calm down a little bit.
Our quality of life, especially when we first started, went steadily downhill. I'm not gonna lie to you. The beginning of the trip was pretty tough.
We also found another leak in the roof.
We would find that all of the troubles we had back home that would make our emotions spike up and down and all over the place were just like nothing compared to the issues we dealt with on the road.
Spray is on and it just started to trickle. I mean, we won't really know if it's working or if it's not working, but at least we still got like at least half the bottle.
When we were in an apartment, we would have rough days, but we'd still have a nice, warm, dry bed to come back to. Here, that's not the case. You know, I'd have a rough day, then I'd have to climb into a 1 foot tall box that's soaked and frozen and has mold in it.
It's leaking again. I think I have more caulking up there than roof nowadays.
We've kind of changed our definition of what quality of life really means. And before, quality of life just meant like our needs met. And I don't think that's at all what it's about anymore.
Our hammock is one of our favorite items, and it folds down really tiny in this bag, and we can sling it up anywhere that we can find two trees or two poles.
I think a quality of life now is about like, am I living an interesting life? Am I doing what I want? We feel now a much greater sense of purpose and of like direction, maybe. Because we're making all our own choices, because we have the freedom to go wherever we want, and we know that the direction we're going is the direction we want to go. That's huge.
When we first decided and first started researching doing the van life, we found the hashtag van life, and then we also found, you know, hashtag van dweller and all these other ones. And there are these beautiful photos on Instagram of people camped up in national parks and exploring, and these like beautiful girls in like these super trendy outfits living in vans and these super trendy vans. We saw that, and then we started doing our own trip, and we realized that the hashtag van life is kind of a joke. And although some days do look like that, and some days, and those are the photos you want to share, so I can't really like hate on them at all. And those are the stories people want to hear, right? People want escape from their world. They don't want, you know, reality. So we sort of kind of started making the hashtag van life into a bit of a joke.
Yeah.
Between us.
There, we're outside of a McDonald's stealing their Wi-Fi.
You know, we've used our Twitter and our Instagram and some different things to kind of make a joke about hashtag van life. So, you know, hitting your head 20 times a day.
Yeah.
Hashtag van life.
Over here you have the vent grill that falls out sometimes when we're driving. That's an integral part of cordon bleu cooking.
Pooping a foot away from your partner.
Hashtag van life.
It's nice you're sitting in the toilet.
As much as it is kind of funny, it is also a community.
Yeah, and it's a community that's existed long before the hashtag van life.
So we met Mr. 100 kilometers per hour maximum. What an interesting guy. He's a Quebecer who's doing the, who's retired and doing the van life in the Westphalia, that he's pimped out diesel TDI conversion with a lift kit and off-roading. He's trying to travel all of North America on just gravel roads. What a cool vehicle. Man, I love this little club that we've entered, you know, getting involved in the van life. It's been just, it's like a little club, like having owning a motorbike or something.
Nice trailer.
Yeah.
This is where all, oh, we should park here. Look, we're here.
What?
Look, all these campers are like us.
Leonard Knight. In 2011, he formed a nonprofit organization to preserve the monument in Slab City. 2007, he was featured in the movie Into the Wild.
Oh, he's dead?
He died in February 10th, 2014.
When you're living in a van and somebody else reaches out to you and they're also living in a van, you have this guarantee that first off, they're going to be weird, because it takes a weird person to do this. But they're gonna get you. They're gonna understand why you're doing it. They're gonna understand like where to park, like the realities of like watching for certain neighborhoods. Do you know where the library is? Over that, okay, we'll go that way, thank you. They just, there's all these things that you just can't communicate to people who live in houses. So last night we just pulled up into this neighborhood and it was really quiet. There was hardly anyone parked on the streets. So we thought, oh, perfect. Well, of course, it's a really rich neighborhood. So we get the cops called on us this morning. None of them were up last night to see us pull in.
Why'd you tell me to stay up here?
Because I didn't want to have to get you to answer all the same questions. They would have gone through the whole process again. I gave them your ID though, because you kept moving around and they kept asking if there was somebody up there. And three cop cars pull up, giving us all kinds of reasons, you know, break-ins and this and that and criminal intent. But yeah, the real reason is because we're in a rich neighborhood. And yeah, so we're gonna head out of San Diego. We're gonna hit up the YMCA and get a shower done and get the hell out of this stupid city. Well, we've noticed, especially if we park in any kind of rich neighborhood or nice area, it's been a bit of a steep learning curve for us, learning that the spaces we thought of as nice before we lived in a van, traditionally rich neighborhoods, nice pretty parks, and places we thought of as sketchy and being, you know, a little run down and a little messy and dirty roads and stuff like that, those have almost flipped for us. What I found though is that, like you say, with hashtag van life, the internet's really popularized the romantic notion of living in a van. And what we found is it's more like a crucible in which to grow. So there's no YMCA in all of Palm Springs. There's five of them, but they're all daycares. So today, I'm gonna try for the first time the hobo shower. Fill up my bucket with water and have a shower. Well, it was the first hobo shower. Definitely not the most comfortable shower I've ever had. Lessons learned, bring flip-flops or water shoes, and half of this bottle is all I needed to shower, but it would have been nice if like half of that was boiling hot water and the rest was cold water, so that wouldn't have been so brisk. It's been this real eye-opener to realize that even though we're not poor, we are all of a sudden, because we're doing this trip, and because, you know, we've noticed them parking in certain neighborhoods and stuff, that
we're at a food for less because they don't have grocery outlets here.
People stigmatize us as being homeless and as being undesirable, and, you know, they call the cops on us and stuff, and that's fine, but it's been a real eye-opener to see what everyday life is for a lot of people in America and in Canada.
So much different than when we live in an apartment.
You have to take everything out of boxes. Yeah, you take it out of the box because the box takes up too much space and the bag can like morph around stuff, so we keep everything in bags. That's why we don't use Tupperware very much.
The reality of living in a small space like this is that you have to use community space. I mean, we go to parks a lot and we go to Starbucks and coffee shops and we try to always put ourselves, yeah, YMCAs, all this.
What a beautiful facility. We just drove here to the YMCA. It is gorgeous here. They have so much accessible to you. But of course, it's like, I really want to skate the skate park, but I have to be like a 5-year-old and sign up for a program. It's totally inaccessible for the traveling van dweller.
We put ourselves in a public space a lot of the time. We are comfortable now doing that, but it wasn't something that came naturally to us. And I think that that is the reality for so many people, but it's also a very stigmatized thing by a lot of people. And I think that we shouldn't do that. Like, our communities are built in these public spaces.
Hi. You comfy? I found the Simon in his natural habitat. You have to be careful not to disturb it.
I think it's in that moment that we really kind of realized how space, private space, public space, it's all a little bit more fluid than maybe we had first thought. That's been a huge eye-opener for me, and I never ever want to like have a home office anymore. I always want to work in a coffee shop. I always want to go to the local park now, and the library, into the YMCA.
How's it going?
It's so good.
We make our income from a few different places. We still have a wedding business that we run together. We shoot weddings for a living. So we're getting deposits and we're getting contracts and stuff while we're on the road. And then we're fulfilling those again in the summer.
I have an Airbnb shoot this morning. It'll be my first Airbnb shoot on the road. Heading off to work.
I also work for Airbnb, which gives us a tiny bit of money, but every once in a while I can do a few real estate photo shoots and that pays a little bit.
This is kind of like what my Airbnb work looks like. I put out my pan in a city and then people can request photography and Airbnb covers the price of the photography. Right now I have 24 photo tickets open, but my big issue is most people don't answer messages in time because they're not paying for it, they're not really invested. So sometimes it's a bit of a pain to schedule everything. So today I tried to schedule like 5 shoots and I only managed to schedule 1. Tomorrow I only have 2.
I'm gonna work on my computer. I think the internet's made this nomadic lifestyle a lot easier for a lot of people, especially when it comes to making money. People really trust the internet a lot more. Like, it's been here for a while, but now I think people are really trusting just people they meet on the internet, and having a certain credibility on the internet makes a big difference. So, like, for instance, we have our YouTube channel and we have our Twitter and our Instagram and all that. That builds up a credibility. And then when we get interested clients while we're out on the trip, they'll Skype us and they feel comfortable sending deposits and contracts and signing us up to shoot their wedding because they've seen all of our stuff. They know who we are through our internet presence. Because I'm a freelance, I believe that the days of like a 9-to-5 career man, that's over. The future is in contracting and being able to be a bit of a jack of all trades and negotiate your own contracts and defend your worth. And like the idea of the house kind of goes in the same step, you know, people being confident enough to know that they don't need a row house because everyone else has it. They need a row house because they need these specific things from it. They need to live in a camper van because they need these specific things. They need to live in a tiny house because they need these specific things met.
Do you want scrambled eggs?
I think that future, as people are branching out, as people are pushing those boundaries and doing those things, it's becoming more and more acceptable for people to do what they actually need and live where they actually need to survive and to be successful. I think that's a hallmark of the future, because we're not in a world where one size fits all works for anybody anymore.
So I'm gonna need some sriracha. Cucaracha.
If you've got any kind of job where you can upload or work or do anything like that, the internet's huge. And we have our Wi-Fi antenna and cell phone plans, and we're pretty much always connected. It's not always fast internet, but at least we're always connected.
How are you liking your reception?
I have none. All the places that are green are the pretty places that have no reception.
You know, you're gonna have to enjoy talking to me and Champ here tonight.
When we were living back in Ottawa, I was going to school and I was working 5 jobs and volunteering everywhere, and I always felt like I had to be doing something all the time, and I have like really bad anxiety, and that was anxiety inducing, but if I wasn't doing enough, it was also anxiety inducing. For me, the van was like a really big wake-up call, because sometimes we just sit around for like 4-5 hours. And I just have to be okay with that.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm not always networking or working on something or, you know, all these different things, and learning that it's okay to just be, and that those things are very important for what you're going to do eventually. And you can't even understand how they're important until you understand how they're important.
We should play cards.
We can't watch movie, play cards, and cook dinner all at once. What do you want to actually do?
I just want to kick your ass. Part of why I wanted to do the van trip was because I thought that it would give me a lot of time to make art. These two cameras have sort of been my project cameras while we've been traveling.
When we got on the trip, I had a really hard time getting started and seeing, sort of putting together all the pieces. I was reading a lot of books about women traveling. So like I read Eat, Pray, Love and Wild, and I just finished reading Gloria Steinem's book about living on the road. I realized that a lot of what these women had in common was they had sort of like an emotional break, and it was very much so about their emotions and about the way that where they were affected them.
Everything that comes in here stays here and then it evaporates. So when the farm started pumping their runoff into this lake and all the salts and stuff, it just kept getting saltier and saltier. And once it's salty, then it has a hard time oxygenating, and then the fish die off from kind of suffocate.
I think I've started to focus more on, instead of focusing outward on all these places that we're going, focusing inward on how it affects me, and realizing that it's okay to live and to create in a place of uncertainty and in a place of awkwardness and it being uncomfortable. And I think that for me, what the trip has become about is sort of taking myself into, like, out of my comfort zone and just even just surviving in a place of being uncomfortable is enough to make you grow and to change you as a person and to be a valid experience. You don't have to set out being like, I'm going to climb every mountain in the U.S. You just have to exist in an awkward state and figure mm-hmm. yourself out somehow. And I mm-hmm. think that that's enough of a goal.
I think what it comes down to is the van really narrows down your mind, right? You now you lock in on just like the few things that you have to do because you know you have to do them. You don't worry about where you're going necessarily, and you don't worry about your career, and you don't really worry about all this stuff anymore. And now all I'm concerned with is, am I going to reach the next gas station before I run out of gas?
This is Simon emptying our septic. But it's only pee though, right?
Mostly. Nope. Pretty far down that hole.
Has its first time in like a month we've emptied it, so.
It doesn't smell that bad. Okay, it smells kind of bad. It doesn't smell.
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
We're chilling out in a grocery store parking lot. There's another camper near us.
We don't want to make a life that we need to vacation from. No. If you constantly are saving up so you can vacation from your life because you hate it so much, then what are you really doing?
Yeah.
Oh, so many coffees.
But I think also the van has also taught me that the idea of like finding peace in a smaller space. Honestly, I think it has to come about from being so frustrated that you have to learn to be happy no matter what.
So after seeing that sign, maybe we'll find another quiet spot. Probably do that. We'll keep moving along. But we'll have dinner here.
That's that has to be where it comes from, because, you know, we're in this small space. We're always hitting our heads. We're always in each other's way. Like, something always broken because it's old. We're tired and all these different things. And then you realize that you just have to be happy inside yourself.
I think that you should note the irony of my shirt now that our home comes everywhere with us.
And at peace, no matter what is going on around you, because it's always changing, it's always chaotic. And that, like, that might be different living in a van versus living in like a tiny home. But I think that honestly, the peace has to come from
internal. Yeah, internal. It has to be something you find, you battle with, and then you find yourself. And maybe that's what it's all about. Maybe it's about putting yourself through the crucible of tiny living to come out the other side as a better, more peaceful person.